From humble beginnings on the Orange County ska scene to multi-million selling albums and massive world tours, join us as we follow Gwen Stefani's amazing journey from just a girl to all-conquering pop phenomenon.
It's really all overwhelming and exciting all at the same time.
Gwen Renee Stefani was born in Orange County, Southern California.
I basically grew up in Anaheim, about 5 minutes from Disneyland, and we were probably about eighth grade, which is about like 13, 14. My brother brought home a Madness record, and that was like, you know, it was the whole time of like the whole British invasion, but Madness and Selector and all the ska bands were a really kind of underground scene that we discovered. When we were about 16, 17, we decided to start our own ska band, and I guess that was out of like boredom in Anaheim. I didn't even sing before that, or, you know, I was only 16, but I never even knew I could sing. We're always satisfied with what we were doing because we always had people come to our shows, and it was on a small scale, but it was, you know, we just never really expected more than that.
No Doubt's energetic live shows caught the attention of the music industry, and the band was offered a record deal.
We got signed in 91 and made our first record called No Doubt that was basically shelved, and we went on tour in vans, and the record wasn't in any of the stores, and we were like horrified.
Since the early days of No Doubt, Gwen had been having a relationship with Tony, the band's bass player.
You and me. Tony broke up with me, and that's when I wrote all the songs on The Tragic Kingdom. I just started writing all these songs. I'd never even done it before, not expecting for any of them to be heard.
I really feel that I'm losing my best friend.
Don't Speak was one of those songs that was labored over. I actually wrote the words at Tony's house on his computer, and thinking to myself when I was writing them, this is so really, really real. This is exactly how I feel. And it makes me want to cry right now. I never in my wildest dreams would think that that song would be like so powerful.
I think Don't Speak's just a sad song. Sad?
Absolutely.
And the winner is...
No Doubt, Don't Speak!
Don't Speak sold 16 million copies of Tragic Kingdom, so it's a really amazing, mind-blowing story.
In order to promote the Tragic Kingdom album, No Doubt hit the road again.
We were not making the popular music. I mean, it was like Pearl Jam, Nirvana, and like, where did we fit into that? They turned us over to the sub-label of Interscope called Trauma Records. These guys at Trauma were like, okay, we think you should go on tour opening for Bush. Well, Bush obviously was a massive band. And the head of like our label, Rob, was like, you gotta meet Gavin since you're gonna go on tour with him. And I was like, whatever. And I just remember looking up at him because he's really tall and gorgeous, and I just was like, wow, there was the arrow, just got like shot like about 50 times. And then that was that. We went on tour, and about 3 weeks into the tour we kissed, and we've been kissing ever since.
In 1999, the band returned to the studio to start work on their third album for Interscope Records.
After Tragic Kingdom, obviously, it was like a big transition. We'd been on tour for 2.5 years straight. We hadn't really been writing, and then we wrote Return to Saturn, which for me was a learning record, like that Return to Saturn phase of your life and like reassessment of everything and who am I. I think when we started talking about doing rock steady, there was just a whole different mindset. I'm just sipping on chamomile. We had always been influenced by ska and reggae music. That was just obviously the anchor of the whole No Doubt band.
Jump on the stage, yes, before we crazy. I'm doing myself in one of them gorgeous ladies.
what happened in Jamaica was there was this music called dancehall reggae, which was like, you know, the modern kind of reggae music happening. And I think that Tony kind of went to Jamaica on a vacation and came home with all this music and was really inspired. Let me just say, I would never ever put baby in a song. Like, I just thought it was too cheesy of a lyric, but I wrote a song called Hey Baby. So it was like all the rules were like thrown out the window. Well, I met Pharrell just by chance. I saw him at the MTV studios and we were walking by each other and I was like, you're Pharrell? And I'm like, I really want you to do this remix. He's like, I've been looking for you. And it was kind of one of these mutual, like we kind of wanted to work with each other. So I kind of begged No Doubt if we could like go in with those guys, and it was a really kind of awkward, weird situation, and we ended up writing Hella Good. I thought that the collaboration was so interesting because it was two different worlds totally coming together.
By 2000, Gwen had begun to record outside No Doubt, initially appearing on Moby's Southside. In March of 2001, Gwen recorded a high-profile collaboration with rapper Eve. Yo,
drop your glasses, shake your asses, face screwed up like you having hot flashes.
I think what happened with Blow Your Mind with the Eve track was I was just a huge fan of Dr. Dre. I'd always be like, if Dr. Dre ever needs me for like a chorus or anything, if he just, anything he wants from me, you know, just tell him I like him, tell him I'm available. But he would never call, you know. But then I got the call. Do you want to do the hook on the Eve track? It was really hard. It was one of the hardest studio experiences I've ever had because he's like a mega crazy perfectionist and he made me do it a billion times and it turned out really amazing.
Eve featuring Gwen Stefani!
After 6 years together, Gavin Rossdale proposed to Gwen on the morning of January the 1st, 2002.
I'm like a week engaged. I can't believe it. It's like a miracle. The whole boyfriend-girlfriend thing's always been a little private issue. So I guess now that we're going to get married, it's like, well, we're married, so I guess you can talk about it, you know, 6 years into it.
Gavin and Gwen were married on September the 14th, 2002.
I guess, you know, it's one of those things that you always dream of, getting married. It was a very romantic, amazing kind of day of like, wow, you know, being together so long and then actually getting married. Engagement is always very romantic. And then the wedding day was just spectacular. I got to wear a dress that John Galliano designed, and it was in England. It was in London. And all my family kind of came over, and it was magic. I don't know. I've never really talked to this about it in an interview before. It's one of those magic days that I'll remember the rest of my life.
Recording began on Gwen's debut album as a solo artist.
Gwen's been working on this side project, this dance record, and working with a lot of talented people.
I have really high expectations for it as far as it. If it doesn't turn out great, it just won't ever come out, so.
Fortunately for everyone involved, the album was a resounding success, and Love Angel Music Baby was released in 2004.
I had the idea of something, a very specific kind of record I wanted to make, but I mean, let's face it, it's a big collaboration between all these amazing, talented people and songwriters that I went in with, and see what it would be like to work with new people just to challenge myself.
Not only did Gwen collaborate with a host of high-profile producers, she also found a new visual inspiration.
Style Muse, at the moment, probably be the Harajuku girls. They got the wicked style, and I'm their biggest fan. There was this area in Tokyo called Harajuku, which is the shopping district, and it's basically a place where people kind of started, kids started gathering on the weekends, and it's kind of parading around and kind of showing their individuality and their uniqueness and their sense of style. It was almost like finding an inspiration, finding a muse, and like having a dream and then making the dream come true. Like, are they here? Is this really real? performing at the European Music Awards when I did What You Waiting For live. You could feel the swelling of excitement for, like, that performance, and it was just an amazing feeling being on that stage. I just felt the excitement of the crowd and the moment of, like, wow, record came out, and What You Waiting For was just an amazing single to come with first, because it was exactly what was on my mind the moment that I was going to start doing this kind of dance record. One of my favorite all-time performances, actually.
What You Waiting For was only the beginning.
You know, this record has been quite a journey.
Love Angel Music Baby spawned hit.
You can feel the energy around this song, Holla Back Girl, you know? You could just feel it.
After hit.
Cool was a song that, one of the first songs that I wrote on the record.
Although we've been through, I know we're cool.
After hit.
Most R&B sounding song is a song called Luxurious that actually me and Tony wrote.
This
we just started talking about doing like a whole nother album with the tracks that never made it on this record, and maybe writing a few more for Christmas. So it's going to be kind of like part two.
Coming up in part two, Gwen talks fashion.
I could just do that full time.
Babies.
Having Kingston is the best thing that's ever happened to me in my life.
And the sweet escape.
I never intended to do another record.